Senator Cornyn, thank you so much for being here. Really appreciate it. I want to begin with this recent NBC Wall Street Journal poll that shows the enthusiasm gap that we've been hearing about so much this cycle narrowing a little bit. It's about a 3-point gap now in Republican favor. Just a few weeks ago, it was a 9-point gap. Are Democrats starting to tune into this election?
Well, you know, every poll is kind of a snapshot, and you got to drill down a little bit to figure out who they're talking to and, you know, what the impact will actually translate into. I think a more reliable indicator is the fact that 4 million more people voted in Republican primaries this year than voted in Democratic primaries. I'm told that's the most since 1930. So I think there's huge enthusiasm, and until the primaries ended on September the 14th, a lot of that was sort of intra-family turbulence. Now we're seeing all that energy directed toward the Democrats as being the party in power.
Right, but the president's out there trying to wake up his base in some way, and I'm wondering if you're seeing some of that and sense that some of these races may start tightening a bit more than we had thought, just because he's being somewhat successful, maybe it waking them up.
My own theory of that is, you know, this election is really going to be a referendum on President Obama's policies, and I think actually his going to these states may provoke a more powerful response in opposition than it does in favor of his chosen candidate. We saw that happen in Massachusetts in Scott Brown's election. We saw it in Virginia with Bob O'Donnell, and in New Jersey with Chris Christie. So I'm not too concerned about the president getting out there on the stump. I would encourage him to go more places between now and November 2nd.
I bet you have specific places you'd like to send it, but I want to go to that turbulence you described. You work so hard at the beginning of this cycle to recruit these candidates, and I'm wondering, when you are on the phone and working hard to get Sue Loudon into the race and Charlie Crist into the race and Trey Grayson into the race and Mike Castle into the race and Jane Norton into the race, because you think they're going to be more successful come November in the general election, do you have candidates now that it's going to be a harder slog because they weren't these folks that you thought would be best for your party on election day?
I totally support the concept that the only people who get to choose are the ones who get to vote in the Republican primary. Actually, the process of candidate recruitment, as you point out, does take cover a long period of time. And there are some people who got in the races early, and of course, others got in later. But I actually think the primaries are a good thing, and we have a lot of people who participated in the Republican primaries who don't necessarily believe the Republican Party is doing as good a job as it should be doing when it comes to fiscal responsibility, for example. So we had a lot of new enthusiasm, a lot of new people participating, and I would say in almost every instance, the person nominated is I think in pretty good shape.
Can you give me an instance that that's not the case?
Well, I would say Delaware is a state where our job is more challenging. But I have to tell you, in this political environment, I don't know how big the wave is going to be and how many people will sweep in. But I wouldn't put anybody, including Christine O'Donnell, out of the game. I just think Mike Castle would have been a lead pipe cinch.
Speaking of Mike Castle, he's weighing the possibility of a write-in candidacy. I think we expect a decision from him relatively soon. Will that cause even more problems for you in Delaware? You want to avoid a write-in candidacy from Mike Castle?
Well, I hope he doesn't do it. Just like I counseled Lisa Murkowski, you could see how convincing I was not to run as a write-in. I think, you know, it looks like you know, when you do something like that, it really, I think people sort of say, well, you lost the race and now you just can't quite accept the outcome. I don't think he can win. I think the only thing he might be able to do is divide up the electorate and, you know, who knows, to help the Democrat. So we are a party committee. We're committed to supporting the nominee in each of these places, and we are.
You had mentioned time and again, this is a two-cycle process, that you're not necessarily trying to say you're getting the majority this time around and the 10 seats you need. Are you committed to sticking around as chair for that next cycle to see this through?
I haven't made a commitment yet, and I'm going to wait until after the election. Actually, the person who chairs the NRSC is elected by our membership. And
you haven't decided if you're going to make a run for it again?
I haven't. I'm going to wait and see how the election turns out on November the 2nd. It is somewhat tempting because well, there are only 9 Republican seats up in 2012 and 23 Democrats. So what the result in 2006, 6 years ago, which was pretty bad for Republicans, now is finally turning to our advantage going into the 2012 election.
I do want to ask you a couple issue questions, if I can, as the Congress is getting ready to go out of town. Been no vote on the tax cuts, the extension of the Bush tax cuts. Again, White House spokesman today on Air Force One blames the Republicans for holding the middle class tax cuts hostage. What is your response to that? And are you surprised that we didn't get a vote on this before the election?
Well, my response is that's absolutely false, demonstrably false. The president was out there saying we need to pass tax relief for the middle class, and there was no bill that was called up by Harry Reid in the Senate or in the House to do that. So there was nothing to hold up. My position, and I think position of many Democrats and Republicans, is you shouldn't raise taxes on anybody during a sluggish recovery like we're in. I think it's the last thing I would want to do if I were a Democrat running for re-election is to go back and tell my constituents that you didn't take care of this before you left town. I think it's frankly irresponsible. It's like not passing a budget.
But one of your main messages from your party this year has been that there's been too much spending, right? And so the Democrats point to the fact that the tax cuts for the upper 2% would cost $700 billion more in deficit spending. Is that not also a message that you've been out there saying too much spending and they would say this would blow an extra $700 billion into the deficit?
Well, the current tax rates have been policy for 10 years. We would have made it permanent 10 years ago if we had had the votes and more cooperation from our Democratic colleagues. So we couldn't make it permanent. We could only make it temporary, and they expire at the end of the year. They'll be the single largest tax increase in American history. So I really think it makes no sense to say you have to raise taxes in order to maintain current tax policy. I think we ought to look at the spending side of the ledger, because I think most Americans today think that the federal government has got its foot on the accelerator and doesn't know how to find the brake when it comes to spending.
If you were to be in the majority come January when the next Congress does convene, how quickly do you think we would see from you guys in the majority a bill repealing health care and a bill repealing financial regulatory reform?
I think pretty quickly. The fact of the matter, though, is that President Obama will remain president of the United States, and he could veto any legislation we're able to pass. Even if we controlled the House, unless we controlled the Senate and got 60 votes, we wouldn't be able to pass any corresponding legislation in the Senate. So I think we need to keep expectations, again, fairly modest as far as what we can do over the next 2 years. I think, it is a chance to work together with the president if he wants to work with us, like President Clinton did following 1994 election, to pass things like welfare reform on a bipartisan basis. The president's made some interesting proposals in the education field where I think there might be some middle ground. I hope we have that opportunity. But I think if the president doesn't reach across the aisle and actually try to do things on a bipartisan basis, the likelihood is not a whole lot of legislating will be done. But unfortunately, we've seen runaway in federal government agencies like the Environmental Protection Agency, like CMS, and like that deals with Medicare, and things like the Department of Labor. We've seen some of these agencies kind of run amok. And I think that's where we're going to have to do significant oversight and to rein them in.
Two more back to politics here for a moment and raw politics, Senate map politics. You guys here at the NRC worked really hard to try to bring on some seats that looked more safely Democratic at the beginning of the cycle, like Washington and California. They seem now to be sort of returning to Democratic favor. Are those seats slipping away from you, Washington and California?
I think it's a temporary phenomenon or aberration, because if you look at how much television is being purchased by either side, there had been a disparity in favor of the Democrats really in Washington and California. Now that's sort of leveling off, and I think you'll see those races get back much more competitive, and I hope our candidates win. We're seeing obviously races like Florida, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Ohio, where literally the Republicans are pulling away in highly competitive areas. And I think there's 35 days left to go. I like the way the trend is going.
In those states.
And I think we will. It'll do nothing but improve between now and November the 2nd.
Are you going to successfully defend every single Republican held seat? Will the Democrats not pick up a single seat here?
I don't think the Democrats will pick up a single seat held by a Republican. I think the only question is what the number of seats will pick up.
Which one of your seats concerns you the most to hold?
You know, I think basically all of them are looking very strong. Richard Burr in North Carolina, David Vitter is up by 15 points or more in Louisiana. Rand Paul is up close to double digits, so 7, 8, 9%, depending on the poll you look at.
So there's not one Republican seat that keeps you up at night?
You know, honestly, no. I guess the ones that I worried about the outcome in the primary, but the way the primaries turned out, I think the strongest candidates were nominated, and I feel very comfortable about all those. So we're looking at playing offense. It's nice for a change not to be playing defense.
Great, Senator Cornyn. Thank you very much for being with us.
Thanks, David.